So, how do you make patients take their medicine? That's a question that healthcare providers have been trying to answer for the longest time. Well, Wealth has an idea. Please welcome to the stage, Matt Loper.
All right, I know I'm what's keeping everyone from open bar or flights or dinner plans, so I'll try to keep this quick. But what we do is we improve patient adherence and outcomes with behavioral economics. I'll tell you a little bit more about what exactly that is in a second, but let's start with why. I have a very serious history of type 2 diabetes in my family. My Auntie Amy, here's me and Auntie Amy back in 1991 in Hawaii, has had diabetes for the past 20 plus years. Every time I visit her to this day, every single pill is laid out in a tackle box. We get home from dinner, she checks her glucometer right away. She's had no complications with her disease state ever since. Her brother, my Uncle Roy, on the other hand, had a much tougher time. And no matter what we tried as a family, we tried everything. We tried bugging him, we tried calling his doctor, we tried putting him into all these different programs. Nothing worked. He ended up on dialysis for a number of years. He ended up in skilled nursing. He finally got a kidney transplant and passed away this year after having a massive stroke. So you have these two individuals with the same exact diagnosis, the same exact disease state, the same exact upbringing, even the same genetics, but massively different outcomes just based on the behaviors that they do every day. And this is one of the biggest problems in our healthcare industry, is that patients just don't do what is rationally in their best interest. They half don't even take their medications as prescribed, like Uncle Roy. So when we think about this problem, we think about why. Classical economics assumes people are rational. Given any choice, they'll make that rational choice every time. What behavioral economics has learned over the past 30 years or so is that's a completely false assumption. People make irrational decisions every day. But if you understand the cognitive biases that cause these irrational decisions, you can actually improve them. For example, let's go back to Uncle Roy just taking his metformin as prescribed. He knows rationally that drug is good for him. He knows it's going to help him down the road. But every time he takes it right now, he feels no different right now. Versus a Snickers bar sitting on the table, he knows too much sugar, I shouldn't eat it, but it tastes really, really good right now. So this is a concept that behavioral economists call present bias. In other words, our human motivation is only driven by instant and tangible gratification. So if you look at any of the other approaches that are being done by other health tech companies, none of them fundamentally overcome this present bias issue. They don't give that tangible and immediate gratification. They push more reminders on patients, which quickly become a nuisance. They push more information and education on those patients. Uncle Roy already knew he should be taking his drugs. More information about his disease doesn't really move the needle. Or they put all these new connected pieces of hardware, put pills in the chips, put pills in the pill bottles, put pills in the inhalers, put pills in the, or chips in the injectors. All these approaches measure data, but don't do anything to improve the behavior itself. So what does? Give that tangible and immediate gratification through a financial incentive. Sounds very simple. Let's pay Uncle Roy to take his pills. But it's extremely difficult, it's extremely nuanced. You have to pay the right incentive amount, you have to structure the incentive correctly, and you actually have to form a habit that sticks. So here's a quick demo of how we do that with a congestive heart failure patient leaving the hospital. At the time of discharge, we say, hey, Jim, there's two very simple behaviors we want you to do every day. Step on a scale every morning so that if you're retaining fluids, we can catch it before you readmit. And take your diuretics as prescribed so you don't retain those fluids in the first place. We really want you to do that, so we're gonna give you $50 today just to download this app. That's an endowed progress effect. Now he downloads the app, he's in. Every day he doesn't do those two behaviors, he loses two of those dollars. That's called loss aversion. That generates twice the behavior change as just paying people incentives. As soon as he wakes up in the morning, we say, hey, time to step on your scale now to avoid losing two of those dollars. He's able to quickly and simply just step on the scale. As long as it's battery, we get the data, we say right away, immediate feedback, great job stepping on the scale, don't forget to complete the rest of your care plan. 30 minutes later, it's time to take his medications. Same exact interaction, we say time to take your medications now to avoid losing two of those dollars. He's simply able to open the app. There's nothing else he can do except for checking his medications. There's no user error possible. He simply snaps that photo of the pills in his hand. We use artificial intelligence to give him that immediate feedback again. Great job, you've completed your care plan for the day, you've kept those $2, and by the way, you just hit a streak of 20 in a row, which unlocks an intrinsic motivator, which is high fives from your grandson to reinforce that extrinsic motivation. So this is what we're most proud of. When we look at patient populations, we tend to select for the highest risk, least adherent, dual-eligible Medicaid, Medicare populations. In all of these populations, the average baseline adherence is far below that 50% rate. However, we've been able to generate up to 89% average adherence up to a full year out after enrolling into our programs. So this is what we're really excited about, is taking these early results and scaling them up and helping as many patients as possible. We serve a number of markets. We started with risk-bearing providers, where we're trying to reduce that readmission rate post-discharge. We're starting to get more and more interest from the health insurers, especially managed Medicaid plans, as we start to look at how do you improve the total cost of care over the course of the year. Really interestingly, we're getting more and more contracts from life insurers. We're trying to use these same approaches to improve the mortality rate or mortality expectation in their clients' lifespan. And then finally, we're starting to talk to pharma. This is the most nascent of our markets. Next week, I'm flying out to Germany to meet with what I think will be our first big pharma client. In all these use cases, they all have huge TAMs with several hundreds or billions of dollars of potential revenue to us. So about a year ago, we were just a really cool company with a great idea, backed on research, great product, but we started launching a few studies. So we had two studies launched last year, Penn Medicine and Princeton. From those great results we've been producing that you just saw, we were able to expand to two paid pilots with Mount Sinai in New York and a managed Medicaid payer in New York. What's really interesting is now within the first quarter alone, we've signed these deals. And of these deals, the two biggest, AXA and New York Life, actually wanted to invest in our company so badly that they closed last week and closed on our first half of our financing that we're currently doing. And over the next 90 days, we'll be rounding out that round. Our team is made up by a bunch of geeks that love the problem and challenge of using technology and behavioral economics to help our patients achieve happier, healthier, and longer lives. And we're advised by some thought leaders in the industry, including the former CEO of the American Diabetes Association, the former head of healthcare investment banking at Goldman Sachs, and the former CEO of the American College of Cardiology. So what we're here today is to talk to risk-bearing providers and payers who want to help join us on our missions to improve the health and outcomes of your members and patients. This toolkit of behavioral economics is underutilized and it can produce huge scalable effects. We really want to work with those who are ready to improve their financial and health outcomes in their patient populations. Thank you very much.